Three readings this morning. First of all, from Genesis chapter 15. Genesis chapter 15, and we're going to read from verse 7. The Lord said to Abram, I'm the Lord who led you out of Ur in Babylonia to give you this land as your own. Abram asked, so Lord, how can I know that it will be mine? He answered, bring me a cow, a goat, and a ram, each of them 3 years old, and a dove and a pigeon. Abram brought the animals to God, cut them in half, placed the two halves opposite each other in two rows. But he did not cut up the goat. Vultures came down on the bodies, but Abram drove them off. When the sun was going down, Abram fell into a deep sleep. Fear and terror came over him. The Lord said to him, your descendants will be strangers in a foreign land. They will be slaves there and will be treated cruelly for 400 years. But I will punish the nation that enslaves them. When they leave that foreign land, they will take great wealth with them. You yourself will live to a ripe old age, die in peace, and be buried. There will be four generations before your descendants come back here, because I will not drive out the Amorites until they become so wicked that they must be punished. When the sun had set, and it was dark, a smoking fire pot and a flaming torch suddenly appeared and passed between the pieces of the animals. Then and there, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham. He said, I promise to give your descendants all this land, from the border of Egypt to the river Euphrates. And secondly, from the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2. Chapter 2, and beginning at verse 1. When the day of Pentecost came, all the believers were gathered together in one place. Suddenly there was a noise from the sky, which sounded like a strong wind blowing, and it filled the whole house where they were sitting. Then they saw what looked like tongues of fire, which spread out and touched each person there. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. They began to talk in other languages as the Spirit enabled them to speak. The Jews living in Jerusalem, religious people who had come from every country in the world. When they heard this noise, a large crowd gathered. They were all excited because each one of them heard the believer speaking in his or her own language. In amazement and wonder, they exclaimed, these people who are talking like this are Galileans. Is it that all of us hear them speaking in our own native languages? We're from Parthia, Media, and Elam. From Mesopotamia, Judea, and Cappadocia, from Pontus, and Asia, from Phrygia, and Pamphylia, from Egypt, and the regions of Libya near Cyrene, some of us from Rome, both Jews and Gentiles converted to Judaism, some of us are from Crete and Arabia, yet all of us hear them speaking in our own languages about the great things that God has done. Amazed and confused, they kept asking each other, what does this mean? Others made fun of the believer, saying these people are drunk. And then finally, from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. If you're using the Bible in the pews, it's page 258, towards the end. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 16, be joyful always, Be thankful in all circumstances. This is what God wants from you in your life in union with Christ Jesus. Do not restrain the Holy Spirit. Do not despise inspired messages. Put all things to the test. Keep what is good and avoid every kind of evil. Oh, we thank God for His word for us. Hunger Games is a series of three books that has been turned into three films. And in a fictional country that's divided up into 12 districts and ruled over very harshly from the capital, people live very difficult lives. The capital ensures that they have just enough food to stay alive. Sometimes children are taken away from their families. And life is generally really tough. The idea being that the people will not have any will or desire, and certainly not any energy to dare to rebel. And as a sign of this force and power over them, every year, two young people are chosen from the 12 districts. And they have to take part in a contest to the death. There can only be two survivors. And this goes on year after year, until one young woman decides that enough is enough. Something within her says, we have to stand up and do something here. And when her younger sister, who probably is about 9 or 10, is chosen for the Hunger Games, she steps up and says, I will take her place. She's known as the girl on fire. It's not easy to work out why that may be. But somebody said, well, maybe it's that her actions catch on like fire as it spreads. We sometimes use the phrase, don't we, about being fired up. We don't mean literally on fire. We mean that there's something that is burning within us. There's something that we feel really passionate about. It might be sport. It might be movies, it might be cooking, it might be in the garden. But we don't stop talking about it. We've always got something to say about it. If it's cooking, then we've always got a new dish that we prepare and we want to tell others about it. If it's gardening, then there's always a new bush or tree to try and grow. If it's a movie, well then either we've just seen one or we know one's coming out. And we'll give time to this. We'll put money into this because we feel really passionate. We feel strongly about it. And as we turn to Acts chapter 2, to read how the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples as they were gathered together, we see that the Spirit came as fire upon them. And I want us to ask this morning, what fire is there within our hearts? What fire is there within us for God? For His Word, for prayer, for sharing the gospel of Jesus Christ. Because fire is what we need. Remember Elijah up Mount Carmel? Gathers the people together. It's time to make a decision. You can't keep going in two directions at the same time. And some people think that the idea there is of a little bird walking along a little branch. Only the branch begins to go in two directions. And the bird tries to go in two directions. And the further the branch moves apart, the further the bird's legs move apart. And you know what's going to happen. And Elijah says, you can't live that way. You've got to make a choice. If the Lord, if Yahweh, if the God who rescued and brought us out of Egypt truly is God, then you go after Him. If Baal's God, well, then all right, go after Him. But You've got to make a decision. You can't do both. It's one or the other. So at that point, Elijah repairs the altar. He sets 12 large stones in place. They've got covered with a little bit of moss and dirt. He cleans them up so they're ready. He gets the wood and he sets that in place on the altar. He takes the animal for the sacrifice and cuts it into pieces and put that upon the altar. That's not enough. There's no offering to God without fire. There has to be fire upon the altar. And there are the words of that wonderful old hymn that asks God, kindle a flame of sacred love on the main altar of my heart. And I hope as we look at the fire of God's Spirit this morning that that might become our prayer. Lord, kindle again, set fire again on the altar of my heart. It'll be hard, can't it? Life is so busy, so precious. Work, home, children to care for, old parents to look after. It can be hard in the culture in which we live that is happy to blaspheme the name of the Lord. It can be hard when all around us, in the newspapers, on the television, on the billboards, the adverts say, if you eat these crisps and you wash with this soap and wear these shoes, life will be full and wonderful. It can be hard. It can be hard in church too. Because sometimes we come, and others around us seem to be full of praise for God, and yet we're in a tough place. It can be hard because somebody comes and shares, and it's great to hear their testimony. But something within just longs and says, Lord, why can't it be like that for me too? And it can be tough for us spiritually. And the question is, where is the fire? And if the fire is there but needs to be fanned into flame again, well then let's do that. If the fire seems to have gone to be so low, then let's seek God to reignite it again. See, as we read through Scripture, fire speaks to us of the Lord's presence. I don't know if we can get some notes up there. That's why we read from Genesis chapter 15 there together. The Lord renews the covenant with Abraham. Abraham, I've told you already, this is the land. Your descendants will live here. And I'm telling you again, this is my promise. Interesting talking with someone before the service. Their name means whatever the Lord says, he will do. And that's what God is saying to Abraham. Look, I told you, and what I've told you, I'm going to do. And Abraham has a question. Lord, how can I know that? How can I really know? How can I be convinced and sure deep within my heart? And so God instructs him to do something that to us may seem a little odd or strange. He's to collect some animals. He's to divide them in two and make two rows of them. But then actually do nothing. Only keep the vultures away from their dinner. Until the sun sets and it goes dark. And then the Lord comes. And the Lord speaks to Abraham. And then the Lord renews that covenant. And as we read, didn't we, there was a smoking fire pot. There seems to be a pot that's got fire in it, in which there is both flames and smoke. But then also a blazing torch. Not one of the little 5-pound ones you can get from a shop and you put a battery in and turn it on. I think probably a big piece of wood that was held, which is clearly on fire. And so this smoke and this fire move down between the row of the pieces of the animals. And that fire, that smoke, is clearly the symbol of the presence of the Lord. And some thought that the dividing of the animals and splitting them into two halves is a statement that if one person in the covenant fails to keep their side of the bargain, they're almost bringing a curse upon themselves, that may they be split in two, may they perish. Interesting, Abram doesn't do anything here. He has this sleep and he has this dream or vision as he's sleeping. It's the Lord himself who comes and renews that covenant. But fire, a symbol, a demonstration of the presence of God. Find the same too when we turn over into Exodus chapter 19. And here the people are at Mount Sinai. In the early part of the book of Exodus, God takes hold of Moses, sends him to Egypt to bring the people out of slavery and into freedom. And after some initial struggles and troubles there, they leave. They're free. They come to the Red Sea, and God makes a way and gets them across. They come to Mount Sinai. And now God's going to keep the rest of the promise that he made to Moses. I will bring you out. I will bring you to myself. And I will make you my people. And so God makes that covenant now with Moses and with the people. But before they meet with the Lord, they need to prepare themselves. Moses actually gives them 3 whole days to prepare themselves to meet with the Lord. Now, with the busyness of life today, that's impossible, isn't it? But you know, we do need time to prepare ourselves in order to come to worship. Because worship comes from the old English worth and ship, meaning the worth that we attribute to someone. It's why in court you would call the judge your honor, because you respect his or her knowledge and understanding of the law and the decision that they're about to make. So it's really important that we make some time to prepare ourselves, because when we come to offer worth to God. We may enjoy the songs, we may enjoy the music. That should only be the byproduct, because that is our offering to the Lord. It's in those songs, it's through that praise, that we actually tell God what he's really worth. And so Moses says, you need to be ready. You need to be prepared. And so they get themselves ready, they get themselves prepared, but they're probably not really prepared for what's about to happen. Mountains don't move. For want something being rock solid. That's usually what we expect of a mountain. But as Moses leads the people to meet with the Lord, it's like a cloud descends upon the mountain. There is smoke. So there's fire somewhere. There's the sound of thunder. And not only does the mountain shake, but so too do the hearts of the people. Because meeting with God is something fantastic, but meeting with God is also something a bit frightening and scary sometimes. Because God comes as a consuming fire. And while fire doesn't always destroy, we always need to be careful around fire. We need to be careful how we come to be with the Lord. But God's presence is shown, is experienced in the presence of fire and the smoke that is there. We talked last week about Solomon and the dedication of the temple. So let's move on and think about Ezekiel. Ezekiel was one of the priests. He became a prophet. He's in Babylon. So he's been taken away from his home. He's been taken away from the temple, the house of God. He is not able now to offer any of the sacrifices to the Lord. He is among the first groups of exiles to be taken away. And all around they see these huge Babylonian temples. And they have the story of how great the Babylonian army is, because it has trampled every nation, and now it is taking control of Jerusalem and Judah. That's the background for the ministry of Ezekiel. But the ministry of Ezekiel begins with that incredible vision described in Ezekiel chapter 1. Have you ever tried to draw it? I'd love you to start reading and see what you can only draw it. But it's like he sees this great cloud and storm coming, with light blazing out from behind the cloud. And then he sees four different creatures. And in the middle of the four of them, this blazing torch, fire. And then the complicated bit comes when you've got wheels, and you've got wheels inside of wheels, and they're going in all sorts of directions, and the creatures are moving. That's the complicated bit. But what is clear is that they are holding up like a platform. And on the platform, there is a throne. It's like those, is it a sedan chair that they used to carry royalty on? When the throne, a very special throne seat would be placed on a platform, and there'd be poles that people could carry them on. That's how I visualize it. But on the throne is surrounded by light and fire. The person that's seated upon the throne is described as being like bronze in the middle of fire. And then Ezekiel sees a rainbow. So you have cloud with brightness of light, and you have rainbow. And so immediately, what does Ezekiel know? The cloud and the fire takes him back to the wilderness when God was leading the people. The rainbow takes him back to the story of Noah, where God makes his promise. So what does Ezekiel know? Sat by the river in Babylon, miles from home, miles from the temple, among the people who are feeling very down. Elijah knows that the Lord himself is there. The Lord who is faithful to his promises. And the Lord whose presence is manifest in fire. So when these disciples see tongues of fire descend upon each one of them, and they're filled with the Holy Spirit, what do they know? They know immediately that the Holy Spirit is God. The Holy Spirit is God who has come to live within them. And who has come to empower them. It has come that wherever they go, every step that they take, that the Lord is with them. And so they are to live day by day with that knowledge of the presence of God. At once, both awesome and fantastic. The second thing I want to say about fire is that the fire of the Lord is something that purifies. Something that makes really clean. And we see that in the book of Malachi. Malachi chapter 3. Find it quickly. I can read some verses to you from Malachi 3, verse 2. It says that the Lord will appear. He will be like strong soap and like a fire that refines metal. Come to judge like one who refines and purifies silver. As a metal worker refines silver and gold, so the Lord's messenger will purify the priests, so that they will bring to the Lord acceptable offerings. So the Lord's presence is described as being like salt, but also as the refiner's fire. That statement's made two or three times. Because we are to note the kind of fire when the Lord comes. It's not a forest fire that just destroys. It's not a fire in a big country house that burns up the logs and leaves nothing but a pile of ashes. This is a refiner's fire. sort of very particular kind of fire, and therefore fire that has a purpose. Purpose being to purify, to refine. Just as fire will melt silver or gold, so that all the impurities that spoil it are resting on the top and can be scraped off easily, then reheated again and the process completed again. It leaves the silver and the gold intact. It's not destroyed. It's made pure. It is made better than it was before. And the purpose of the fire of God's Spirit is just to burn impurities, to burn away those unclean actions, those bad words, those impure desires, but yet not to destroy us, rather to refine us. Just as the end result of the refining process is pure gold, so the end result of the fire of God refining is in order that we may offer acceptable sacrifices. See, that was the problem within Malachi. The people were offering sacrifices, okay. They even would come and pray, even show some kinds of repentance with some tears, but tears really were just empty. Because the sacrifices were not the best. See, when God gave instructions for the sacrifices, they had to bring the best. You don't bring a little lamb that's been born blind. You don't bring an animal that's had an injury and isn't going to live for very long. You bring the best that you've got. That's what they weren't doing. And so the Lord refines first their thinking and their hearts in order that they may bring the very best. And so too the Lord with us. We don't have any longer the need for animal sacrifices. The gospel tells us that our Lord Jesus, the Lamb of God, gave his life once and for all, and once was enough, sufficient for all time. But Hebrews says we do bring the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of lips that honor him. The challenge is as one sacrifice of praise we bring. The Lord wants to refine us so that we bring acceptable sacrifices. Nothing less than the very best when we meet together. Thank God for our musicians and our singers. You know how often you see them here on a Sunday during the month. That just doesn't just happen. Every week, for an hour and a half, 2 hours, we're looking at those songs, thinking about them, making sure we've got the timing right. Even then, we don't always get it perfect. But at least we try. We put some real effort into that in order to bring a sacrifice that is pleasing to the Lord. John the Baptist talks about fire. He says that he baptizes with water, but when he's coming, he will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. Now, somebody, good commentators, think that the context there is that of judgment. I'm not going to necessarily disagree or agree with them. I think that the context is much more that of bearing fruit, because both Matthew and Luke go on to talk about the fruit of repentance. So for me, the idea of fire there is that same thought from Malachi. A fire that will burn up the wrong things. Will burn up the wrong desires, whether it's a greed or sexual immorality. Will burn up the wrong words, whether it's a lie or whether it's to blaspheme the name of God. Wrong actions, whether it be to steal or to injure. fire of the Spirit will burn, not to destroy us, not to consume us, but to refine us and to purify us. And James and Peter both talk about troubles being like refiner's fire. And we all know that in this world, there are enough troubles, and trials, and temptations, and difficulties. Life is tough sometimes. That's how it is within this world. But both James and Peter show to us that God can use us, like the refiner's fire, to purify us. So fire speaks of the Lord's presence. Fire comes to purify us, to refine us. Thirdly, this morning I want to talk about that fire of the Lord's passion. Because to be fire, or to be on fire, is to be excited, it's to be eager, it's to have zeal, it's to have love. And so for the fire of the Spirit to burn within us, means that we have a passion and a love for God. Came a time when Moses sent 12 of the leaders into the land of Canaan to have a look, to see how the lie of the land was, so they were prepared for when they went in. And after a little while, the 12 of them come back, and they've got these huge bunches, we buy little packets of grapes, don't we? They came out with these huge branches of grapes, and all 12 of them agree, it is wonderful in there. Milk and honey, that is just words. You should see it. The Lord is going to bless us so good. I mean, it's no use. It is brilliant in there, but there's no point even trying. It's absolutely brilliant, but we can't get it. Because the cities are too big. The walls are too high and too thick. And the people, well, they're a lot bigger than we are as well. And so 10 of them say, we can't do it. It's Joshua and Caleb who say, they're right, but they're wrong. They're right because it is great in there. They're wrong because we can go in. Because if the Lord has promised to give it to us, and if the Lord is with us, then however big the challenge, we can face it. And Moses makes a promise to Caleb, that he will live to enter the land. You see, for the next 39, nearly 40 years, they wander in that wilderness. Eventually, Joshua and Caleb and the new generation enter. And Joshua is portioning out the land. So he gives to one family an area of land. He gives to another family another area. And to another family another area. And then this old man comes. Caleb. He's 85. But he said, Joshua, listen, you were there. Moses made me a promise. God made me a promise. I would have some land, and I want it. I'm 85, but I want it. I'm 85, but that doesn't matter. I want what God has promised to give me. Why? Because there's something within his heart that is burning. There's a passion that is there. In fact, he's probably burning more because he's waiting 40 years for this. There is something that is burning deep within him. We don't have time to talk about David. Remember David when he brought the Ark of the Covenant to the city? And the musicians are playing, and the singers begin to sing, and David doesn't have to stand still at that point. Not only is he singing and maybe waving his arms around, but he's dancing as well. His wife looks out the window and thinks, oh my goodness. And she tells him as much when he gets home. What a spectacle you made of yourself today. What do you think the servants saw of you? Now, David's not spoiling for a fight here. But he does say, actually, I don't really care what the others were thinking. And it's that kind of fire and passion that we need within our hearts. It's that kind of fire that Paul says to the Romans, never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor. And in 1 Thessalonians, rejoice, pray, give thanks, and do not quench the spirit. In those words, to keep spiritual fervor is a word that talks about a pot of water that's beginning to boil. The fire has been underneath, the water has been heating, and now it's beginning to bubble and to boil over. Paul says, don't ever lose that. Don't lose it. We said earlier, didn't we? Life is jolly tough sometimes. And maybe really tough for you at the moment. Maybe tough at work because it drains you physically. By Friday, you just feel exhausted mentally and emotionally. It may be rough at the moment in our studies because there's so much to do, deadlines to meet. It may be tough in marriage at the moment. It's not always great, is it? It should be, not should be always great, but it should be great, but it isn't always. And there are tough times to get through. There are tough times in family. And while the children aren't well, you're up 2-3 times in the night and still got to go to work in the morning. One of the children is upset in their school. We hit rough times in our health. We experience pain. We have a long wait for tests to give us some idea of what's going on. And let's also be honest, it's rough spiritually sometimes. Some Sundays we wake up and actually we just like to turn over and pull the duvet up. And not go to church. But some mornings when we know we've got to get up and go to work, we don't feel like reading, praying for a few moments. We can think back to better days, when yet there was a fire that burned within, and there was nothing that we wouldn't do for the Lord. And now it seems so different. To be honest, the world really only gets the leftovers. It can be rough in all sorts of ways. Hard, spiritually. Let's not condemn, or point the finger, or judge. Rather, let's be there for one another. Alongside of one another. Maybe we're listening. Really hear. And to pray for them. Because you know what? It only takes one spark to reignite the flame. To set our hearts on fire. And that fire is something that keeps burning when we are together. You take a coal out of a fire, or a piece of wood out of a fire, and very soon it will start to burn. The fire will come. We need fire that is within our hearts, which is an individual thing. But like the disciples on the day of Pentecost, we need that shared fire. That's the kind of church that I hope we want to be. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, for those days when it seems that the flame burns brightly, we give you thanks. And humbly recognize that it's due to your spirit at work with us. recognize that times lack his wrath. For some of us, it may be work, maybe ill health, maybe a crisis challenge in our marriage. But it may be in terms of our faith. We just don't have that passion that once we had. And Lord, this morning we want to ask that you might kindle a flame again on the altar of our hearts. Lord, if it's just one little spark, we'll set things on fire again. Lord, that's what we see. We may know your presence. We may submit to your refining process. And that we may have hearts that are passionate to know you, to walk with you, to love you, and to serve.